නිවැරදි තීරණ තමයි මගේ සාර්ථකත්වයට පාර කිව්වේ.
විෂන්කයා විශ්වාසනීය දැක්ම.
National Intellects Organization was formed 2 years ago in order to create national policies for Sri Lanka. As a country, we have lacked national policies for the longest years. And we see as the governments change over every 5 years, the policy of the country changes. So this disrupts everything that happens around the country. And I think we have witnessed the shortcomings of each sector in Sri Lanka. So National Intellects Organization became a part of NPP, National People's Power, now one of the main contestants for the upcoming presidential election. So our candidate is Mr. Andhra Kumar Dissanayake, and the professionals around National Intellects Organization, the young professionals and the senior professionals who has done a lot of work for this country, who has immense knowledge on each of these areas, have now rallied around AKD to make that significant change in Sri Lankan political history. So when it comes to policy making, the base of the policies has been evolved around national unity, social justice and equity, and rule of law. So if you really look at the country, one of the main issues we face is not implementing the law. So we have enough laws, we have enough policies, we have enough people to lobby for the change, but we don't see the governments who has ruled, has anybody was keen to implement. So we believe this is a major part of to do with intent. So, and as professionals, we believe we have found a team, a political alliance, who has the intent to make this change for the country. So as we look at youth side, so we don't necessarily take youth as isolated policy or youth giving certain demands for youth as an isolated activity. So this youth solutions, the solutions for the younger generation, only comes through an integrated solution. So in the policies that we have developed for the country, it will start from the economic policy. How do we really conquer the world or improve our national income as well as government income and provide the right infrastructure and facilities to people? So that economic policy is embedded with a manpower plan and a workforce strategy. So this workforce strategy really boils down to education. So these three things are very much integrated, and the youth requirements are mostly fulfilled within these three policies. And also, as NPP, we are very keen to bringing arts and culture into the aspect so that we create a youth who has empathy, who can care of others, and also who has a vision for their life. So these integrated strategies will become youth activities, and certain elements of youth will be embedded in each of these policies, and I invite you to read these things carefully. So when it comes to youth, we also are very keenly identifying one major problem we are facing, especially in Sri Lanka, but it's a global problem, is youth radicalization. What do we mean by youth radicalization? Actually, youth is radical, which is good. Youth has to be radical for change. But currently the youth radicalization is defined as youth getting extremely violent on certain aspects, or either politically or religiously or socially, the youth is driven to be violent. This is happening through smaller segments or fragments of the society. They influence the youth, they use the energy of the youth to be radical. So in a global context, the reasons of youth being radical, one of the main reasons is injustice. Injustice in economically, injustice in rule of law, injustice and social reforms make youth very insecure. And also, it makes a good ground for ideologistic people to influence these youth for radical behavior. And also, you are very aware today's technology is very, very fast, and it has reached all of us. So given the technology is very, very much personal level, the radicals can use this technology to pinpoint you, segment you, and provide the right information for you to influence you to be more radical. We have seen this very recently also in Sri Lanka. We use social media to make very much hype on ethnic and religious and political issues. And then thirdly, we see that political and religious groups are trying to rule the countries as segmented silos. So you have a different religious groups, you have different political groups with different ideologies. So it is very difficult for youth to get out of this radicalization. They will get caught. The only way that we can avoid this is, as youth, we need to be very much understanding of the context and the background of the messaging that we get. So in terms of eliminating or eradicating this youth radicalization as a problem, countries have looked at as a national problem, and they have found counter solutions. Most of the countries who are very much capitalist, and even in Sri Lanka, we have been using counter-terrorism as one of the tools to eliminate youth radicalization. So that means you segment one society or one group of people, and you use terrorist prevention activities to avoid the conflict. This continuously pushes that segment of the society to be more radical, to be more deprived of the rest of the equation. So therefore, the most advanced strategy that is being used to eradicate youth radicalization is dialogic, evidence-based approach, where the social integration happens, and through education, through evidence-based approach, we have to prove to people who has radical ideologies that they are in the wrong place, and that they need to work as one society and respecting everybody else's lives. So in terms of national people's power, we feel as professionals this is one of the major issues the youth need to be addressed, and the leadership of national people's power has proven that they have the policies and they have showed their willingness and the practice that they can solve this issue. Especially now it's been defined as a security issue. Actually, it's not a security issue. It's actually a issue between few communities where we don't respect each other. The reconciliation has not happened the way it should. Today, you would see that both parties are using extreme groups for their political campaigns to win votes. Either they give extreme demands of certain groups to win. And only difference you will see in national people's power, the leadership, especially Mr. Anurag Kumar Dissanayak and the people who are politically active, has no such base. The people who are rallying around us, even from minor communities or ethnic communities and groups, are not joining us because of some demand is given. They are looking for justice and equity, and the only place that has, who hold that values as the core values, is national people's power. So I would like to invite youth to understand this new political culture, a culture where youth become activists in politics, and we are being very concerned and active in politics, and also politicians who will put their personal interest back of their mind, and they will always bring the social and the country's interests up front when they do politics. So let me end this appeal with two examples. So you would have seen in a few months ago in Christchurch, when the attack happened on a church, on a mosque, how did their prime minister acted? Jacinda Ardern, she acted very wisely as a leader to ensure no further conflict, no further aggregation of violence is avoided. In countries like us, what happens is an incident will always be used to aggregate another community or to use violence against another community, and the leadership does not take any steps. So very recently you would see in media also there is a conflict between two groups in Kerala. So these two groups are fighting each other because of the use of beef. One community uses beef, other community does not use beef. And it is going towards a violence. So until the country has a policy and the national leadership has a practice and strategies to integrate societies, as youth, we will have continuous problems. We will be influenced, we will be forced, we will be used to create conflicts, and these countries will never move forward. So at last, I would invite all of you first to look at national people's power as your alternative. We have been asking for an alternative. We have been asking for a change. Now it is there with you. And now you need to explore, especially this policy book that's been presented, what's been said there. Make an informed decision whether the information that is given is true or false, whether that can be done, whether that can be done practically, and decide your vote wisely. We are moving into a digital and we are moving into a world of information. Now, National People's Power has given you information. Do not take information that comes through Facebook and that comes through main media, because all of them are biased. So the only way that you can make a wise, smart decision is to reach to the source, identify the information, and then make a smarter choice. And I believe that all the professionals who are in Sri Lanka, who believes in change, professionals who are abroad, who looks forward to a change in Sri Lanka, will look at National People's Power with fresh eyes and make that significant change for this country, where the country's destiny will be decided on 16th of this month, and you will go and cast your vote in front of Anurakumara Dissanayake and the compass, which is here to show you the direction. Thank you.
Breaking.lk.